Jamie Josta from Hatebreed, Kingdom of Sorrow, Josta. I run Hateware. I got my label. You know, I do a bunch of different stuff. I actually got into the music industry. I got into music around 11, 12 years old. I went to a camp for troubled kids. My mother sent me away for 2 weeks, and the camp counselor had like Minor Threat and Bad Brains and Fishbone and Mighty Mighty Bosstones and played me a lot of stuff. He also had some like more kind of hardcore stuff like Judge and Cro-Mags, and I really, you know, started making a lot of mixtapes, and I would go down to the record store and get you know, vinyl and cassettes, and sure enough, I saw a flyer for a show. And right around, right before my 13th birthday, I went to the show, and I noticed that at this place, it's called The Moon in New Haven, you could meet the bands, like right as they walked off stage. There was no barricade, it was like a little tiny dive club. And I thought, man, that's so cool, you know, and I started talking to some of these guys, and I thought, if these guys could do it, I could do it. And then I read that these guys were looking for a singer, and I went. I didn't tell them how old I was. It was probably right after my 13th birthday. And they said, yeah, you could be in the band. So I started booking shows. We did our first show when I was like 13, 14, maybe right before my 14th birthday. And yeah, just from there on, I was hooked. I've grown colder from the mercy of who's looking down upon the silent graves of those who pay with sin. I've grown colder. I actually, in the early 90s, or yeah, probably, I want to say, I don't know, maybe mid 90s, there was VHS-like tapes floating around of UFC, and, you know, Tank Abbott and the Gracie, you know, Family Dudes and Shamrocks, and started trading like VHS tapes, you know, and watching the fights. And then as the 90s went on and it started to get, you know, more popular, I started hearing about other promotions, Pride, and, you know, we could get pay-per-views and stuff. And then into the 2000s, I just kept following it. UFC started, you know, they got bought out and they started to get, you know, more and more events, and I started, you know, liking different fighters. And then when Tough, I think, I want to say right around when Tough premiered the first season, I thought, man, I gotta do music for this, you know? So we did, we contacted them, we did a CD called the Ultimate Beatdowns Volume 1 for UFC, and it had Hatebreed and Slayer and Sepultura and American Head Charge, a bunch of bands. Our management at the time got Chuck Liddell in the American Head Charge video, and I saw that it really helped them kind of, you know, branch out into a new audience. You know, it was like almost similar to metal in a way, because a lot of people who are, I guess, you know, into violence, like that aspect of the fighting, the adrenaline, and, you know, kind of living vicariously through the guys. You know, you're watching someone beat the shit out of each other, but it's almost like artistic in a way. And same with metal, you see the pit and you see people going crazy smashing each other, but there's a lot of work and creativity that goes into it, as, you know, as does MMA. So there was like a lot of similar lines. And then I got contacted by a friend about doing entrance music for Andrei Arlovsky. So I wrote that song, and that ended up, he ended up, you know, becoming champ, and I started going to fights. You know, I flew out to Vegas, saw him fight, went to Mohegan Sun in Connecticut, I went to a couple other events, and they ended up using the song in the Strike Force video game for him. So that got a lot of notoriety, and people would, you know, email me and write on my social networks that, you know, they heard it in the game and stuff, which was really cool. And just since then, I just, you know, different opportunities have opened up where, you know, I sponsored Shane Carwin, which, when he got beat by Junior Dos Santos, which was very upsetting, but, you know, it was still cool to see my logo and everywhere. And then I sponsored Bobby Lashley, I sponsored Matt Schnell, who was on the MTV show Caged, which that got me a lot of exposure, you know, because he's got such a huge social network fan base. And then, yeah, just more guys started approaching me. Brian Cobb, I sponsored, you know, I did a lot of stuff with the MFC up in Canada here, you know, and then got guys in Legacy, got guys in Bellator, got guys in World Series of Fighting, and some of the smaller promotions, Shark Fights, and, you know, it was started becoming really cool to see when it would be on TV, my logo would come up, the guys would thank me, and then the orders would start rolling in, and, you know, I just do it for fun. It's not like, I don't really care about making money. That's the beauty of having a couple different careers, is that I'm not looking to exploit the MMA fan base. I'm just looking to, you know, support these younger guys who I think, you know, could go far, you know, especially like someone like Bobby Lashley, who's already kind of has notoriety from wrestling. It's a great, he's got a great attitude. He's got a great message, and he does a lot for kids. And I always, you know, said with Hatebreed, I wanted to like take back the word hate and use it for good, like use the negative for positive. And he's somebody that, you know, he's kind of polarizing in a lot of ways where it works to sponsor him because, you know, he uses the negative for the positive like I would. Yeah, that was screwed up. I still don't know what I can technically say. I know that the lawyer, you know, contacted us and everything, but I did one interview and I think I probably said too much in the interview and they got upset. And so right now I'm just waiting to hear back from Dana. I saw as soon as that happened, Dana followed me on Twitter and I direct messaged him and I didn't hear back. And then I saw UFC followed me. And then I think UFC Canada followed me too, because wasn't that fight in Canada? Yeah, and so, but I don't know because, you know, it's really strange because right after that, we got music licensed in a Fox TV show. I'm not sure if I can say what TV show it is yet, but also they licensed the logo to be on a shirt in the TV show. And today I got an email saying that the shirt and the song are gonna be in the show like October 23rd on Fox. So it's, you know, being their parent network now, I just wonder why, you know, they got worried about, you know, associating themselves with us. You know, if you Google us, you know, there's a lot of rumors and bad stuff that comes up. All of it's untrue, but, you know, we've never had any sort of racist agenda or hateful agenda. Like I said, you know, we always use the word hate as kind of like deconstructionism, like taking it back. It doesn't belong to just people who are racist. You know, you can hate poverty, you can hate injustice, you know, social injustice, you can hate, you know, moral standards or, you know, whatever. It's not just for people who hate one race or one gender or one whatever. I think that stuff's BS anyways. I think when you hate someone based on, you know, the color of their skin or their religion or whatever, I think it really says more about yourself and stuff, something that you're going through, than it does the other person, you know? No, and that was, you know, in my opinion, that was really disheartening, especially since we're on the UFC Volume 1. I've had the music, I've sponsored guys, and, you know, like, I aggregate a lot of traffic to their site. Like, I've had some people behind the scenes hit me up and say, when I tweet about an event or when I post on Facebook or whatever, like, I'm right up there with Snoop and other people who are, you know, where they're seeing hits from, you know, so, and I'm a genuine fan of the sport and I'm a genuine long-term fan of the UFC, so it was just really disheartening, but I'm hoping for the best. I'm hoping it gets worked out, you know, we'll see what happens. When you're running a major corporation, there's a lot bigger fish to fry than just one band or one song, you know. I get it, I understand. Not in the UFC, no. But like I said, like I see some of these younger guys, it's almost like signing a band in a way. If you see a kid like this kid, Matt Schnell, he's getting better, I like his style, and he's got that it factor where, you know, when we put out his walkout shirt, girls are ordering it, people are ordering it, people are retweeting it, and, you know, it's nice when stuff lines up like that. I feel like it's it makes me feel like I'm doing something good to help somebody on the way up. Well, for UFC, I probably couldn't do with Hatebreed because there's a sponsor tax, and it's just too out of my ballpark, you know. And like I said, I don't really do it for money. I do it for fun. I just happened to turn a profit the last couple of years, which was great. You know, like back way back when I was in Hot Topic with Hatebreed, and when we were, you know, featured in big films, and when I was doing Ozfest every summer and stuff, it was more corporate, where I had other people, you know, dealing with it, you know, and I had a merch deal and I had reps, you know, that would deal with retail. Now I'm just doing it with myself with two other guys, and I just do it through the web, and I actually like it better that way. I actually feel like it's kind of more DIY, and the direct to consumer sales is great to me because I'm not out there trying to push a retailer to stock a guy's walkout shirt, you know? And for me, you know, I'd rather just deal directly with the consumer right now. If it came back and I, you know, they said, here, go into Hot Topic or Spencer's or whatever, like I saw, you know, Brock Lesnar had his stuff in Spencer's. That's really cool, but I'm not on that level. I don't have the fan base of a Brock Lesnar, so I'm not really expecting that. But for smaller guys and for smaller companies, like I really like this, you know, Americana MMA. I think they do some cool walkout shirts and stuff. They, you know, they did, they've done band gear, Sepultura, Sick of It All. That makes sense because there's crossover there, you know, and I think if you like a fighter, hit them up on Twitter or hit up the manager. A lot of these managers are always looking for new opportunities. Some of these guys are really proactive. Like one of my favorite guys to sponsor is Emmanuel Newton. And I was doing him back in shark fights and stuff. And I think when he was, I want to say he was in Legacy too. Or no, MFC. But, you know, like his manager, he's in Bellator. He had a great knockout, highlight reel knockout of King Mo. And that Hatebreed shirt was everywhere. It was on every, I mean, I think it even made it on ESPN. And so the value is there. You know, everybody hit me up from all over, like, oh my God, I saw Hatebreed on Jim Rome on CBS and all this stuff, because he's moshing in the, you know, in the cage after the knockout. And that was just simply a matter of him liking the band. His manager knew my guy who, you know, helps me with my MMA stuff, and it worked out. I guess it's a lot of networking too, you know.